Superconducting materials seem miraculous. Their resistanceless flow of electricity has been exploited in some powerful ways, like the super strong magnets used in MRIs, particle accelerators, and fusion plants. And then there's their bizarre ability to levitate in magnetic fields. But the broad use of superconductors is limited because they need to be cooled to extremely low temperatures to work. But what if we could produce superconductivity at room temperature? It would change the world. Recently, there's been a media flurry around a material known as LK99. A group of researchers claim that it exhibits a phenomenon as coveted as cold fusion, perpetual motion machines, and decent frozen pizza. They claim that it exhibits superconductivity at room temperature. Now, a superconductive material has zero electrical resistance, but it normally requires extremely low temperatures to work. A room temperature superconductor would have incredible implications. Levitating cars on magnetic highways, super powerful magnets in everyday applications, and overclocking your computer to ridiculous degrees without melting it. And that's just off the top of my head. Sadly, LK99 did not turn out to be a room temperature superconductor. It was sort of faking it. But does that mean that the dream is dead? How plausible is room temperature superconductivity? How did LK99 manage to mimic the phenomenon well enough to trick its research team? Now, we talked about the underlying phenomenon behind superconductivity when we talked about quasiparticles and Bose-Einstein condensates, but we never got to the really cool stuff, so it's worth a deeper dive into superconductivity. But before even that, let's remind ourselves about regular non-superconductivity. So a conductor is just a material in which some of the electrons are free to move. Normally we think of electrons as being bound into their atomic orbitals. Sometimes the outer shell electrons are shared between atoms in molecular bonds. In conductors, there are either extra outer shell electrons or electron holes that can jump pretty freely between adjacent atoms. Add a charge or voltage differential across the conductor and a stream of electric charge, a current, will flow. In a regular conductor, current doesn't flow completely freely. The conduction electrons can interact with each other or with non-conducting layers of electrons. All that bumping around manifests as heat. Atoms begin jiggling. Electrons move randomly. This saps energy from the current and results in resistance. In fact, the hotter the material, the higher the resistance, because the random motion inhibits a nice smooth flow of electrons. And cooling a conductor decreases resistance. So it might seem reasonable to wonder how low resistance can get. For example, if you get to zero temperature, zero jiggling, do you get zero resistance? The universe really satisfies our most simplistic extrapolations, except in this case. Near zero resistance is possible, although it's not for simple reasons. In 1911, the Dutch physicist Heike Kamerlingh-Onnes followed exactly this intuition. He managed to cool a wire of mercury below 4.2 Kelvin, roughly the temperature of deep space. At that temperature, all resistance in the mercury vanished. This was the first observation of superconductivity. Onnes also discovered superfluidity in helium on the way to making the temperature low enough for superconductivity, and scored a Nobel Prize for his foundational work in low-temperature physics. Superconductivity and superfluidity are closely related. Both enable resistanceless or frictionless flow, and they can lead to cool things like permanent vortices, whether physical whirlpools in superfluids or permanent electrical eddies in superconductors. Zero electrical resistance by itself is quite nice. But it's not as flashy as the fact that superconductors can make things fly. Well, can make them hover. Fast forward to 1933. Lots of people were messing around with this fun new physics toy, including Walter Meisner and Robert Oxenfeld. They were the first to make a superconductor float above a magnet. This is the Meisner-Oxenfeld effect, or more commonly these days just the Meisner effect. Sorry, Robert. Okay, so what's really happening here? We can predict what'll happen to a superconductor inside a magnetic field if we know just a few things. 1. Electric currents generate magnetic fields. 2. Magnetic fields also cause electric currents. And 3. The electric current caused by a magnetic field will itself generate another magnetic field that works to counteract the original field. If you apply a magnetic field across a normal conductor, the induced electric current will somewhat counteract that field. But there's a limit because the resistance of the material will limit the strength of the induced electric current. But if you apply a magnetic field across a medium with no resistance, the induced electric current can get strong enough to completely cancel out the initial magnetic field. In fact, all free electrons in the superconductor will quickly spiral along the magnetic field lines and set up vortices of current at the surface, persistent currents. Those little current loops don't take any energy to maintain. They act like little electromagnets that exactly cancel the incoming magnetic field within the material, and we call these shielding currents. Okay, so far so good, but why all the floating? Well, push together the same pole of a pair of bar magnets and they will repel. But we can think of the surface of a superconductor as being layered with electromagnets. Another way to think about this is that the magnetic field lines expelled from the superconductor pile up on the outside, causing an intense magnetic pressure. This effect is nicely described by the London equations, figured out by the German brothers Fritz and Heinz London in 1935. They found that in a material with zero resistance, magnetic field had to exponentially decay inside it. These guys were able to explain the Meisner effect based on the assumption of perfect conductivity, without having any idea why superconductors have no resistance. One other subtle assumption in the London Brothers theory is that the system should be in an equilibrium state. They figured out how things should look after the electrons finish rearranging themselves into whatever final configuration of currents and magnetic fields were induced. They took time out of the equation. So the next advance was made by putting time back in. In particular, by thinking about the transition into and out of the superconducting state. That change is what we call a phase transition, closely related to the more familiar state transitions between solids, liquids, and gases. Russian physicists Vitaly Ginsburg and Lev Landau realized that there are certain general rules that all systems undergoing a phase transition have to obey, even if we still don't know the actual nature of the post-transition state. So, in 1950, still not knowing what caused superconductivity, we got the Ginsburg-Landau theory. This new mathematical description of superconductivity predicted everything that the London theory predicted, but also some new weird stuff. And this new way of looking at superconductors yielded another Nobel Prize shared between a few contributors. To start with, they predicted that there are two types of superconductors that behave very differently around the phase transition. For regular states of matter, the phase transition point depends on both temperature and pressure. Water boils at a lower temperature on a mountaintop. But the phase transition point into superconductivity depends on temperature, pressure, and magnetic field. These materials have to be below a certain critical temperature, above a critical pressure, and below a critical magnetic field. The old London theory allowed any amount of magnetic field to be expelled by the superconductor, but the new Ginsburg-Landau theory said that if the field gets too strong, then superconductivity will break down. And fair enough, any material only has so many free electrons, so there's a limit to the strength of the shielding current. With this new understanding came the prediction of brand new superconductor behaviors. For example, that there should be two broad types of superconductor, type 1 and type 2. Type 1s are the delicate snowflakes of the superconductor world. If you put one of these into a magnetic field and crank the field just a tiny bit over the critical value, its superconductivity will vanish almost entirely and instantaneously. But the type 2s are stubborn and have trouble letting go of the past. When you crank their magnetic field beyond the critical value, they cling to some of their superconductivity by entering an intermediate state called a vortex state. Remember the vortices of electrons that made up the shielding current on the surface of a superconductor? These descend back into the material, threaded by growing magnetic field lines. This leads to a cool new phenomenon called flux pinning. In this vortex state, the magnetic field can penetrate the material, but only in very restricted ways because it has to line up with the vortices within the material. A superconductor in a vortex state will both levitate and be fixed in a particular orientation in the magnetic field, as if suspended by wire in an art gallery. It's worth taking a second to appreciate that all of these insights and predictions about the behavior of superconductors came without knowing why superconductivity happens in the first place. They came from thinking about how the universe must behave in order to be internally consistent. But I guess that sort of describes all physics. It's incredible how far we can get just by insisting that the universe behave itself. But still, it sure would be nice to know how superconductivity actually works. Because if we know that, then maybe we can figure out whether room temperature versions are possible. And if you've watched our quasi-particle episode, then you may remember the answer, but let me give you a refresher. So we're now in 1957. John Bardeen, Leon Cooper, and John Robert Schreifer came along and changed everything. Together, these three developed what is known as BCS theory of superconductivity, for which they won the 1972 Nobel Prize, and if you weren't counting, this is the third superconductor-related Nobel. Remember that resistance is caused by electrons being jostled out of a nice streamlined flow, random collisions leading to exchanges of energy. Superconductors are in a strange state that makes those energy exchanges impossible. As the material is cooled down, traveling electrons set up these patterns of oscillations in the nuclei of the material's crystal lattice. The electrons sort of ride these waves in pairs, what we call Cooper pairs. Now, electrons are of the fermion particle type, which means no two electrons could occupy the same quantum state. That type is determined by the electron spin. Any half-integer spin particle is a fermion, so that covers spin half electrons. But Cooper pairs typically have spins of 0 or 1, half plus half or half minus half, which makes them bosons, and bosons behave very differently to fermions. Any number of bosons could occupy the same quantum state, so our material gets cold enough, and these coherent oscillations allow Cooper pairs to form. All of the Cooper pairs drop down to the lowest energy level. Now, from there, it should be possible to excite a Cooper pair back up to a higher energy state through some collision. But in a cold material, collisions aren't energetic enough to allow that transition. In quantum mechanics, you can't excite a particle only halfway to a new energy state. It is all or nothing. In the case of the superconductors, it's nothing. No excitations are possible, so no collisions happen. There is no resistance. So, finally we understand how superconductors behave and why they behave that way. Maybe we can figure out whether room temperature superconductors are even possible. At first glance, it doesn't look good. Coldness seems necessary to get electrons into a Bose-Einstein condensate of Cooper pairs and to avoid knocking them out of that state. And for a while, it was thought that superconductivity could only occur in pretty extreme cold. But then, in 1986, a couple of IBM researchers, George Bednors and K. Alex Mueller, managed to create superconductivity in a ceramic material 35 Kelvin, and others soon managed to get the critical temperature up to 93 Kelvin. That was a game changer, because it meant that superconductivity could be produced using liquid nitrogen rather than liquid helium, a much cheaper option that opened up the technology to industrial use. Bednors and Mueller got the Nobel for their demonstration of the newly emerging field of high-temperature superconductivity, and we've actually stopped counting the Superconductor Nobel Prizes, and this wasn't even the last. We've now managed to induce superconductivity in exotic ceramics with temperatures as high as 133 Kelvin, and higher still for materials under extreme pressure. but that's still way colder than the room temperature superconductivity claimed by the recent result. And so it still requires expensive and cumbersome cooling apparatus. So is room temperature superconductivity possible? We don't actually know, because we don't fully understand how any high temperature superconductivity works. It's certainly not quite as simple as Cooper pairs riding waves of oscillating nuclei. For example, a common class of high temperature superconductor involves thin layers of copper oxides interspersed with other materials that provide free electrons. There are different stories for how the Cooper pairs form, and a single mechanism hasn't been settled on yet. That means it's very difficult to know the maximum temperature for which superconductivity is possible. Okay, so you and I now know quite a lot about superconductors. Maybe it's time to try to debunk the recent claim of this phenomenon in LK99. So the team claimed a massive drop in resistance below a temperature of 127 Celsius, so actually quite a bit hotter than room temperature. And the material also appeared to partially levitate in a magnetic field. But since then, a number of teams have synthesized the same material and report no evidence of superconductivity. Speculations about why the original team thought otherwise include that their sample had an impurity that made it just very conductive, regular conductive, but not superconductive. And that the levitation was probably just regular ferromagnetism, not the Meisner effect. Not that the original researchers should be criticized for this. They found something cool and reported it. If anyone is to blame for the hysteria, it's the media, who went crazy for a paper that hadn't even been peer-reviewed yet. But overall, this was a good thing, because it gave us a chance to talk about superconductivity, which is surely one of the coolest, no pun, phenomena in our generally phenomenal space-time. Hey everyone, so we wanted to let you know about our Patreon. It's an incredibly helpful way to support the show and ensure our survival long term. If you join, there's lots of amazing perks, including monthly Q&A live streams, access to episode scripts, and even a private chat with me depending on the level. And every level includes access to our Discord, where you can interact with other community members 24/7. Another way to support the show is by visiting our merch store, where you can score some sweet space-time swag. And as always, subscribing, hitting the bell notification, and joining the early gang when new episodes drop is a great way to support us.